Keshav, can you hear us?
Yes, very much. Thank you.
All right, Keshav, I think we are all set. And 71 participants have already joined the session. I am going to just say a welcome to everyone and hope you find this session useful. And over to you, Saily, who's the host and senior product manager of Triggers. Saily, over to you.
Yes, thank you so much, Sheesh. So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the webinar. My name is Saily. I'm a chartered accountant, and I work as the senior product manager for tax at Triveris. So in today's webinar, we will be discussing about the widened scope of equalization levy and its implications. And similar to the last webinar, I will briefly introduce our two expert panelists. We will then start the discussion around today's topic, and then we will take questions from the audience. However, you may start posting your questions in the Q&A tab that is visible on your screen during the discussion. And we will take up the questions which are relevant and related to the ongoing discussion. And the remaining questions will be taken up at the end. So starting with the introduction for the panelists. So today with us, we have Mr. Keshav Loyalka, the Group Tax Head at L&T Financial Services. Keshav sir is a CA, CS and IIMA alumni with over two decades of experience. He has served in the banking, financial services and manufacturing domains and has industry expertise in the areas of tax planning and managing tax litigation for international taxation, transfer pricing and GST issues as well. He has been an active speaker and has represented the financial sector on income tax and indirect tax related issues before the government, industry bodies and professional associations like CII, ASSOCHAM, IBA, etc. So welcome Keshav sir. So we also have Mr. Narendra Kumar Jain, who is an advocate and a proprietor at NNMS Legal Chambers. He has more than 15 years of post-qualification experience in advising clients and handling litigations in income tax, transfer pricing, corporate tax, and international taxation. He has also authored multiple books on taxation. He has also presented papers at many conferences, and he also serves as a faculty for CA final students. Additionally, he is also a convener of the Bangalore subgroup of Chamber of Tax Consultants. So with this, I once again welcome our expert panelists and all the participants to this webinar. And before we go to the topic for today's discussion, I would like to understand Keshav sir and Narendra sir's first reaction to the current situation and how the lockdown has impacted their businesses.
Hi, Narendra Jain here. So this has been an unprecedented event in the history. It has been it has brought in a great amount of change in way we function, and it is going to impact the way we function in future. Generally, as practitioners, we are used to a lot of filings, paper filings and court appearances, and given that all of that is closed and how we don't really don't know how they would again open and what form of activity would be there, at least in the near future, there would be a good amount of change all of us expect during this period. But it is a good learning where we can spend this time in enhancing our skill and learning. And there would be wide impact. Entire impact is not, we cannot visualize the entire impact now.
Keshav sir, your views on the current situation and the lockdown and its impact on your business.
Yeah, thank you, Saily. And a good afternoon, all the participants. These are really an unprecedented time, as Narendra told. We are looking at something, a situation where maybe not our grandparents have seen. And in these challenging time, there are more newer avenues. And one such avenue is that the way we are connecting today to discuss something as exciting as equalization levy. And just as the title suggests, urgent imposition, it looks me like there is a googly bowled at the last over where even the batsman doesn't know that he is bold and there is no possibility of a third empire. I'm jumping to the straight to the topic, but there is a great excitement in terms of analyzing this equalization levy and e-commerce and accordingly 194O TDS obligations. We'll try to deal with, and as first of all, disclaimer that these are my personal views, and as a student of law, I will also try to go down this path of understanding these provisions and trying to find some solutions. But coming to the COVID impact, it is going to have a significant impact. The way I look at it from my business, I come from a banking and financial background. It is going to be significantly impacted because of the primary reason that our borrowers will be having a tough time. There would be delays in terms of EMIs, etc. Government is taking a lot of efforts. RBI is quite proactive. However, the real impact and how soon we will be tracked is only a matter of guess as we speak. But still, I am quite a hopeful and optimistic person. I feel with the kind of discipline through which we are working, we should soon be on track.
Yes, thank you, sir. So, as mentioned by Keshav sir and Narendra sir, this is a challenging situation for all of us. But one good thing is that technology is helping us stay connected, and it is definitely changing the way we work. And we all have been forced to take the digital way of life these days, whether we like it or not. Actually, we have known for a long time that technology is a necessity, but nothing has made this fact clearer than the global coronavirus pandemic. So coming back to our topic, talking of the technology and the internet, the World Wide Web and mobile applications are majorly used for trade and commerce. And websites and applications like Amazon, eBay, Alibaba, Flipkart, Make My Trip, etc. They have major mediums, have become major mediums by which transactions are carried out and have completely revamped the way businesses are taken, are carried out. And in addition to this, the online advertising has become as significant, if not more, than the traditional modes of advertising like print, television, hoardings, etc. So essentially, we can say that the electronic modes have blurred the geographical boundaries and has made it difficult to identify the actual physical place or the point where a particular activity in the chain of transactions which has taken place in this entire e-commerce transaction. And consequently, as we see that e-commerce has led to making the taxation complex, and hence we can see there is a lot of litigation on this subject matter. And adding to all of this, the newly introduced provisions widening the scope of the equalization levy and TDS, which came as a surprise to all of us. This has been imposed at the time when the OECD is still developing a consensus on taxing the digitalized businesses. So having said all of this, I would request both the speakers to put some light on the existing and the newly introduced provisions, and also highlight the impact of these provisions so that the audience is more clear on our on the newly introduced provisions under the law.
Daily, before Narendra explains, may I request you to click the next slide. And I would like to say something here. See, we are on a Friday. I think today is a Friday, yeah. So there is no new release. But we tried to make this discussion a little interesting by putting up something as a food for thought. And what we are trying to say here is that we talk of a Star of the Wars. And just a few facts in relation to that movie. It says the movie is produced by Walt Disney Studio. There are British and US actors involved. Movie has been shot in UAE, UK, Iceland, Ireland. Special effects have been carried out in several countries, US, Singapore. IP of the movie resides in US. And on top of it, it is screened throughout the world in theaters, in different modes of other modes of digital. And then if somebody like us with a taxation mind think that which country or which jurisdiction should tax income arising from this entire value chain and to what extent, that's itself can be a good topic for an entire discussion. But I just want to open the floor with this inaugural slide. Over to you, Narendra.
Thanks, Keshav. We'll take it forward from where Saili and Keshav have left. Very interesting facts have been put by Keshav on the slide. And this is how the world has evolved in last 3 to 4 decades. Constant changes and way that technology has evolved. It has impacted all aspects of life, not just taxation, but whether it is our social lives, our political lives, our personal lives. So taxation is just one part of it. And given the new situation we are all into, and the way we are discussing, there is no physical presence. This entire webinar is happening just where everyone is there accessing through their home. So the technology has enabled many things, and the businesses have evolved and changed through the technology. And globalization along with technology ensured that the doing business across the world became easier. One of the aspects in which the traditional tax principles depended was the physical presence or physical location and the nexus, which was established whether in our section 4, 5 and section 9, that there should be a nexus with the source country or the market country from who wanted to levy tax on this. And all that nexus was generally based on the physical presence. But the technology has made it possible to do businesses without physical presence. And we have many, many examples. As we go forward into this webinar, we will see those examples where it is possible to do businesses without physical presence. The tax had to naturally evolve based on that. And we all know there was a BEPS Section Plan 1, which extensively dealt with these kind of a situation. And the BEPS Section Plan suggested 3 different models. Those were all suggestions. There was no finalization of that. They said we will finalize this in 2020. These suggestions were which India picked up. The suggestions were that there could be an equalization levy, there could be a significant economic presence test which can be put into the domestic laws, or there could be a tedious provisions on the remittances which are happening through that source country. India adopted these, and not just one, India adopted all of them. If you see, the tedious provisions are quite wide. Even prior to 2015, the 2012 amendment to the royalty definition tries to cover a lot of digital kind of services within its ambit. We had equalization levy to start off with in 2016, where a specific segment of digital economy advertisement was targeted. And then it gradually expanded into significant economic presence, 2018 Finance Act amendment, which brought in the concept of transaction-based SEP, if the transaction is happening or there's an user interaction through digital means, which try to bring in that aspect as well. Now, this is significantly enlarged today. So India targeted all the 3 aspects. They thought that it is better to approach all the 3 rather than waiting for the finality, what the BEPS Action Plan would come. Based on the final conclusion, which happens at G20, maybe India changes its strategy further. But currently, we are with a situation where we have SEP, we have equalization levy, and we have tedious provisions in our statute, and we need to look at the interplay of this. This was further expanded by the 2020 Finance Act, which brought in the equalization, brought in additional items in the equalization levy of 2016 equalization levy. And also, there is a change which has been done in the SEP definition, which is no doubt effective from the subsequent assessment year. But for the financial year 2021 and assessment year 2021-22, we have an equalization levy on e-commerce transaction. I'll briefly explain the provision, which will set the floor for further whatever questions we have designed for today's discussion. So there are 3 important aspects that we should be aware of, or which we need to analyze, 3 important definitions which we need to analyze for us to see that what kind of transactions the equalization levy can be applicable. These are e-commerce operator, that there should be an e-commerce operator. Then that levy is on e-commerce supply and service. So what is e-commerce supply and service? Then the online definition, which is there in section 164 of Finance Act 2016. So these are 3 important aspects then we need to understand. And then there's a charge under 165 capital A. I'll briefly take this so that we get in platform for the question and answers. So e-commerce operator means a non-resident. If you look at the earlier equalization levy of advertisement, the levy was on the payer, and the payer should have been resident in India. So if the resident is making a payment, he was liable to pay the equalization levy. That has been amended in the new equalization levy, whereas the charge is on the non-resident e-commerce operator. So this is an important aspect, that who is an e-commerce operator. The definition under 164CA says that he is a person who is a non-resident who owns and operates or manages a digital or electronic facility or platform. So there should be an electronic facility or platform which enables the sale of online sale of goods and online provision of service. So these are the keywords here is online. Now, online is also defined in 164 to mean a facility, service, or a right or a benefit or an access which is obtained through internet or any other telecommunication network. So it should be in something which is accessed through internet. It could be a facility, it could be a service, it could be a right. So it should be online sale of goods and online provision of services. Then what is e-commerce supplier service? This is again a critical definition which is there in 164CB, which says that e-commerce supplier service would mean online sale of goods owned by the e-commerce operator. So first category is online sale of goods owned by the operator. Second category is online provision of service by the e-commerce operator. So these are both where the e-commerce operator directly involves in the sale of services or directly involves in a provision of services. Sale of goods or provision of services. The third category is an interesting category, and which is what's so very relevant, the kind of business models which are there today, that online sale of goods or provision of services are both facilitated by e-commerce operator. So if an e-commerce operator facilitates in particular service or a sale of goods, online sale of goods, then this would be covered. Fourth is a combination of this. So basically what they are trying to say, if you take a simple example that it is an Amazon USA, if he sells the goods directly, then he is covered under clause 1. If Amazon USA is rendering certain services to customers in India, then it is covered under item 2. And if there's another e-commerce participant, say for example Dell USA, which wants to sell it goods, and the Amazon USA is facilitating that sale of goods, then the third category is covered. Now, if it falls in these category, then the equalization levy is charged. Now, equalization levy, here again, the charge is on the consideration received or receivable by the e-commerce operator from e-commerce supplier services. So it could be consideration received or receivable, and from whom it should be received. It should be received from a person resident in India. So if a person resident in India makes a payment and that consideration is received by e-commerce operator, the charge is fastened on such kind of e-commerce supplier services. So there should be e-commerce operator, e-commerce supplier service, and a consideration received. These are triple tests that we need to keep it in mind. So one is where the payment is received from the consideration is received from the person resident in India. That is one category. Second category is if the consideration received from a non-resident, but under only certain circumstances, because that becomes an NR to NR transaction, territorial nexus becomes an issue, and whether India can levy tax on such a territorial nexus is an issue. As we go forward, we'll address that. And under specified circumstances, what are specified circumstances? I'll come to that. And third is where a person purchases goods or services through an IP address located in India. So a third category is that there could be a non-resident who comes to India and he accesses the services of this non-resident e-commerce operator through an IP address located in India, then the third category would be triggered. The levy is on consideration, and consideration is something which we'll have to understand, that because there are a lot of issues here where the e-commerce operator is directly selling, so the sales become a consideration. But in certain circumstances, he may be only facilitating. That's the third category, as I discussed, and we discussed the definition of ESS, electronic supplier services. Now, in those circumstances, the consideration should be taken as the commission which the non-resident, the e-commerce operator, non-resident e-commerce operator receives. Because if you look at the way the section 165A is being worded, I would feel that it would be on the amount of the consideration which the e-commerce operator receives, and not the entire consideration, which portion of which will go to the actual seller of the goods or services. Now, what are the specified circumstances where there is a non-resident, where there is a sale from a non-resident to non-resident? The specified circumstances are two, where there is a sale of advertisement targeted to customers in India who may be resident or in India, or who may be accessing the IP from India. So if there is a Singapore person making a payment to Amazon USA or Google USA for advertisement which are reflected or which are targeted to the customers in India, that transaction would be covered under the equalization levy. Then sale of data collected. So Facebook collects data of the customers in India or the person who accesses the IP in India. That data which is collected, and subsequently sold by Facebook, say to the third parties outside India, non-residents outside India, that would again be liable for equalization levy. So these are two specified circumstances where sale between or a transaction between a non-resident to non-resident is also covered under the equalization levy. So these are three broad categories of items on which if any consideration on received on these items, then the equalization levy is charged for these items. There are exceptions which under 165 capital A 2 that if the e-commerce operator has a permanent establishment in India and that transaction is effectively connected to the permanent establishment, in that circumstances, the permanent establishment, those cases will be outside the 165 capital A levy. Then equalization levy, which is covered under 165, will not be liable under 165 capital A because there the percentage is 6%, here there's 2%, naturally they want to tax it at 6%. If the turnover of the e-commerce operator with respect to e-commerce supply and services in India is less than 2 crores in the previous year, then such an e-commerce operator will not be applicable. For such an e-commerce operator, the e-commerce equalization levy will not be applicable. So this is how the broadly the transaction or broadly the section or the provisions are structured. We will have to go into more detail of this as we go into the question answers.
Sure. Thank you so much, sir.
Sorry, Saidi.
Yes, sir.
No, thanks, Narind. I think you have laid the broad framework of the equalization levy brought into now. I was just wondering that what was such a hurry of bringing this amendment on at a time when the entire world is suffering from this kind of COVID thing. And I tried to find some rationale that there would be certain pressing thoughts in the minds of legislator when such a large change, which has a wide-ranging implication, has been brought in. So there is a clearly significant shift happening from a traditional economy to a virtual economy. The good old concepts of a physical presence and no PE and no profit attributable, so no tax, is no more acceptable in this world. And as you touched upon, as Narendra touched upon, BEPS Action Plan 1, which was inconclusive, or rather it's a work in progress, which laid three alternatives. And India was the first country to adopt and go for a unilateral action of moving with the equalization levy. Now, I tried to figure some data and just sharing to give a perspective of the kind of transaction which we are talking about. And there is a report which suggests that online digital transformation in the country is expected to increase India's total internet user base by 829 million by 2021. India's expected turnover is around 85 billion online and $200 billion by 2026. From a $38 billion number in 2017. So if we see the growth rate in overall economic commerce is significant, and we are one of the fastest growing economy in that respect. And again, I try to connect with some of the thing which we are as an individual are connected. We hear about Flipkart and Amazon Big Billion Day Sale. And there is a data which suggests that on the 5 days, 6 days of that sale, they were having 70 billion views and 10 TVs were sold per second, first hour of the sale. So the point to make all these data is to give a context of the pace at which we are moving to embrace the digital world, digital economy, and the very fact that we are connected with this VC mode on such an important discussion it itself a testimony that digital world is going to be the new normal. Data is the oil, and hence possibly the legislature does not want to wait for one more year to lose a significant portion of tax revenue, which if it can garner, why will it not garner? In my view, that may be a good intention. However, the important aspect which is missed in this side is there is no memorandum explaining the amendment. There is no discussion on the floor of parliament. So this is going to impact the entire business and the way the law is drafted. As Narendra explained, it can be a combination of anything. Even if an e-commerce operator provides certain services or goods which are not owned by it, or even it facilitates, it can come in the MB. So that is where I feel lot work need to be done. And if I try to relate it with a global context, see, India, following India, other countries also started following up on this kind of unilateral action. UK introduced in July 2019 a digital service tax, which has also become effective from 1st April 2020. But the point here to note is that they gave at least more than 9 months or 10 months for people to understand the change, to give the comments, put things in public domain, and then depending on the business realities, the law is finally enacted. Here, as we are talking, this entire digital thing, each business, each category of business has its own kind of nuances. And unless those nuances are properly addressed, taxation thereof unilaterally on a flat percentage will create more challenges.
Great, sir. Thank you so much. Everybody must have gone through the newly added provisions. And all of us might have realized that there appear to be various open issues and confusion created due to the broad language used in the amendments. And while we expect some clarifications and FAQs in due course on the new scope of equalization levy, let's understand the personal or individual views of our speakers on certain issues. So a few of the issues might have already been addressed during the discussion that happened right now. However, we'll just break down these questions for the audience to understand more about the new amendments. So let me share my screen. Every slide will have one question and our speakers will tell us their personal views on that. Okay, so I hope everybody is able to see my screen. So going to the first question that we have for today. So considering the definition of e-commerce operator has been kept wide, whether it includes a person who does not own the platform, but only manages it.
So if you look at the definition of e-commerce operator, it says he's a person who is a non-resident who owns, operates, or manages a digital or electronic facility. So owns, manages, or operates a digital or electronic facility or platform through which the online sale of goods or services take place. Because the words use or, so because it says on, owns, operates, or manages, a normal literal interpretation would mean that even a person who does not own but only manages in online platform will be covered within the definition of e-commerce operator. But here we need to understand that what do you mean by these words, owns, operates, or manages? It should not cover, it is the core activity of managing the platform, and it will not cover certain ancillary activities which may take place. For example, if someone is managing the warehouse for an e-commerce operator, we cannot say he is managing a facility or a platform for the e-commerce operator. If he is doing delivery for that, he may not be covered within these definitions. So only where a circumstances where it is there that the platform itself is managed by someone else, though it is owned by someone else, and only activity that is done by the person is the managing the e-commerce platform, may be defined as an e-commerce operator. Possibly they have kept the definition wide to because there could be situations where the entities may try to break the operations into different subsidiaries where one owns the platform and other manages and other operates it. So therefore, to try to that kind cover that kind of situation, maybe this wider definition is used. And therefore, if anyone only manages the platform also, he could be treated as an e-commerce operator.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is, how do we deal with a situation where there is an overlap between the provisions of the equalization levy and the income taxable under the Normal Income Tax Act?
Yeah. So as I said, if I may take this, basically, this there are already provisions under the Act regarding the significant economic presence. And as there is no consensus on over OECD, the provisions have been deferred for next year. However, we have gone ahead with the equalization levy on e-commerce. So there are areas where there would be an overlap. There is a possibility where these overlap will be clarified. But the real challenge right now is that these should be addressed in the rightful spirit. One other example which comes as an overlap, that there is already a levy of fee for technical services, and there is a withholding tax on that, royalty and withholding tax. So that is subject to 10% withholding tax. Now, can one say that now instead of a payer deducting 10% withholding tax, it is the buyer, it is the seller who should be liable for equalization levy? That would be possibly a beneficial. If I am a recipient of such services from a non-resident, I would say that you give me a declaration that you will comply with the equalization levy and I need not withhold 10% withholding tax. So that is something, a possibility where a conflict may arise. However, if one were to look at it, this is the entire rationale for bringing this is to introduce some new kind of transaction or certain transactions which we are not getting tax already. So tax department may always challenge this position saying that no, that is not the intention, that royalty and FTS will continue to remain as a 10% liable to withholding tax. You cannot push that to equalization levy. There are certain other challenges which possibly these, in the interest of future litigation, government should take up and clarify.
Sure. Thank you so much. So let's move on to the next question. So applicability of new provisions to goods and services which are physical in nature and where e-commerce merely facilitates communication, placement, or conclusion of the order.
This is an interesting aspect because the way the provisions are worded, it's pretty wide. If you look at the beginning of equalization levy in 2016, they were only meant, if you look at the committee report which had recommended equalization levy, they were only meant for something like advertisement or something with services which could be rendered from the digital platform. And they had made an intention clear that the goods may not be part of this equalization levy. Even if you look at the laws enacted by other countries, like example UK, the physical delivery of goods where all the other activities are outside India, outside that particular country, are not part of the levy which has been made on digital transactions. Now, what could happen the way our provisions are structured? Say, for example, a customer in India or a person resident in India places an order on Amazon USA for a delivery of a particular mobile or a laptop. All the activities related to that have happened outside India, and the transaction, only the delivery through a courier agent will happen in India. Now, the courier agent would pick up the item from, say, US, from the US location and deliver it to the customer in India. Now, if you look at the definition of e-commerce supply or services, it says that where e-commerce supply or services means online sale of goods owned by the e-commerce operator. Or it could be also a situation where it is facilitated by the e-commerce operator. Now, if you have to look at literally these provisions, the answer would be yes to this question. Because is there an online sale of goods? There is a sale of goods. The title of the goods have transferred from the Amazon to the customer in India? Is it through an online mechanism as the order is placed online, the conclusion of contract has happened online, and it has happened through the medium of internet, which is the definition of online. So if I go by that literal definition, then it would mean that even these kind of transaction where all the activities related to that has happened outside India, someone has placed the order and the goods are delivered in the physical form to the customer or person resident in India, then the transaction is, the equalization levy is applicable to that kind of a transaction. So on literal reading of the provisions, yes, but this would open a constitutional challenge to the provisions, because where the goods, sale of goods have happened outside India, where the title of goods have transferred outside India, can equalization levy or can a tax be levied on such kind of transaction? Is there sufficient territorial nexus just because the customer is in India? Now here only the customer is in India. Just because the customer is in India, will there be a sufficient territorial nexus for these kind of a transaction? This is why it would have been more proper to keep goods outside this levy. But the way it is structured, the answer would be yes, but subject to the constitutional provisions.
Okay, but what happens when sale of goods is via an email or a phone call where purchaser places an order?
See, as Narendra explained, the definition, the way the act has been drafted, it is quite wide. And it is not only dealing with only a sophisticated medium of e-commerce. So if we technically try, somebody wants to interpret, it can even cover that part of the activity also within the ambit of this levy. See, but as there would be a practical challenge in terms of how one would do such kind of compliance. So if, for example, if we have to take a case, like if sale of goods via email is to attract, then even a communicating the order, it will have its own consequences.
Sure. So coming to the next question. So in case of Netflix or Amazon Prime, where the subscription fees are paid by a person resident in India and the subscriber gets only the viewership rights. So will there be implications under the equalization levy provisions?
Yeah. So again, we need to go back to the test as what is e-commerce supply or service. So there as we have seen the definition, there are two aspects. One is goods and services. Now naturally this cannot be classified as goods. If I pay a subscription fees to Netflix or Amazon Prime, then it cannot be classified as goods. So now the next question is whether it can be treated as a service. It can be treated as a service. Now here, if you look at the way some of these operators are active in India, there are two business models that they have adopted. One is that they can do a direct sales to customers in India. Like I am a person resident in India and I directly subscribe to the Netflix USA or wherever it is, and I make a payment to him for the subscription fee. Now the question is, am I getting a service from Netflix or am I getting a right to view the content or right to view the particular content? That could be something which will have to be determined. Is Netflix really rendering a service? Now, if you look at the definition of service under the CGST law, section 2102 of the CGST Act, there they have defined services as anything other than goods. Can we then import that meaning of service into the income tax law or into the equalization levy and say anything other than goods will be naturally service for the purpose of definition of what is e-commerce service? And if that definition were to be adopted, then it could be covered here. There could also be an argument that I'm only getting a right to view the content and it is not a provision of service. Service may something, some kind of a service should be rendered, like a professional service, technical service, or these kind of things. That would be something in which is an area of dispute. But if you look at the intention, they really want to cover Netflix kind of a situation or Amazon Prime kind of a situation within this. There could be another business model which they are adopting, where they set up a subsidiary in India and subsidiary acts as a distributor, reseller of the subscriptions or reseller of the, so Indian customer makes a payment to the Indian subsidiary and Indian subsidiary in turn makes a payment to the foreign foreign company, which is actually the e-commerce operator. The Indian subsidiary is not the e-commerce operator, which is just a reseller. In that kind of a circumstances, the consideration is received from the subsidiary, by the parent company receives the consideration from the subsidiary for which it has given the right to distribute this content further or distribute the subscription further. In the second situation, the Netflix is still an e-commerce operator. It is still getting the subscription. Now, again, the same question would arise whether it is an online sale of services. If you look at the broader purpose of this levy, they would naturally want to cover it, but whether it is in services is a debatable issue, and which will have to be naturally, we'll have to wait for certain clarification on this point, but it could go either ways on this particular point. And we'll have to say whether the right to view the content, can we say that they have provided a service to the customers in India?
And just to top up, I think while there may be debate, the intention of the legislature is to clearly tax these kind of services, whereas there would be challenges as to the content, some of the contents which Netflix, Amazon or other such mediums stream, they may not be operating it. They are just having that platform, allowing people to access that content. No, whether they, again, then can there be a segregation of that, the only the net in-house owned content should be liable to equalization levy, or the entire consideration should be liable to levy?
There I would feel that it would be both, because if you look at the definition of e-commerce supplier service, it covers two things. One is provision of service by the e-commerce operator itself, or provision of service where the e-commerce operator is a facilitator, or he facilitates the rendering or provision of a service. So if we say that viewership of a content is provision of a service, then in either circumstances, in my opinion, it should be covered.
Okay, so we spoke about sale of goods and sale of services. What would be the implications while accounting for cancellation charges, discounts, or sales return?
See, these are all normal business scenarios which will happen as any transaction happens. While yet there is no clarity on these things, but if I try to do the compliance, I understand this is a quarterly compliance which needs to be. Really, if there is any sales return or there is any cancellation, I would believe that adjustment can be allowed. However, the suitable clarification is still awaited on these.
Okay, sure. And what happens when a medical opinion is received through video conferencing medium?
Yeah. So this is again an extension of what we discussed earlier, that how do you understand these transactions where the medium is still online? So if you do it through video conferencing, the opinion is given, or consultancy is given through online. It could be even in the case of a chartered accountant or a lawyer who is giving an online consultancy. Why just restrict it to medical opinion? So the ambit would, if we say it is covered, the ambit would be fine. But here we need to understand how the particular person is operating. Is he, how a medical opinion is given? Because there has to be an e-commerce operator. Now let's take a couple of examples to have clarity on this. And that would be also be applicable to other discussions what we had. Say, for example, the doctor is rendering the services directly. I know the doctor, or I get to know the doctor through a particular referral. I email my reports to the doctor, and doctor goes through the report and he gives his opinion, he gives his advice. You just extend this doctor thing to anyone, maybe any profession, this would be applicable. The question is the doctor who is doing this service on his own basis, is he an e-commerce operator? Now, e-commerce operator, who is someone who runs a platform or runs a facility for rendering e-commerce services or for sale of e-commerce or for sale of online sale of goods. So if a doctor has to provide the services directly, I don't think he will qualify as an e-commerce operator. The levy, the charge is on the e-commerce operator. This would again be extended similar, something like an email. If I'm sending an email and I get a response by email, then that cannot be treated as an e-commerce. You cannot say that email is an online facility or platform. Look, I am a user of that email facility, but the doctor or I or anyone else does not own, manage or operate the email. So it is email by usage of email by itself cannot be treated as an e-commerce facility, or you cannot treat a person as an e-commerce operator on that purposes. But if the doctor is on certain platform, say for example, in India also, we have quite a few platforms like Cult and Cure.fit, where the doctor is rendering services through those platforms, and you really make the payment to the platform, and platform in turns make the payment to the doctors. Now, if that kind of a scenario is there, if suppose there is something like a non-resident platform which is expert in giving medical advices, I registered as a user on that particular platform and then share my reports, and through that platform, if a medical opinion or a consultancy is given, even a lawyer, legal consultancy or tax consultancy is given, then that would be open to equalization levy. Ultimately, there has to be someone has an e-commerce operator and someone who can be defined as an e-commerce operator. If you cannot bring in someone in the definition of e-commerce operator, just because the services are online or the placement of order is online, in my opinion, the equalization levy will not be attractive.
Okay. So let's move on to the next question. So are there any implications under section 206C where goods are sold by the e-commerce participant? So will there be two separate levies on a single transaction?
Yeah, so now basically from this question onwards, mostly we are moving to the domestic transactions. So this is again in interesting provisions 206C read with and 194O, which are brought in by this particular Finance Act 2020, which also have wide implications. I'll give a brief outline of these two sections so that we have, and then we go into the questions related to these sections. Now, if you look at 206C, there is a subsection 1H included, which provides that if there is a sale of goods exceeding 50 lakh rupees, then there should be a TCS at the point at the rate of 0.1% on such sale consideration. There are other conditions in terms of the who is a seller, who is a buyer. Let's assume those conditions are satisfied for a moment. And then those particular transaction, even if they're a sale of goods, the tax should be collected from the buyer, and the seller should collect a 0.1% of TCS and remit it to the government. Similarly, they have brought in the provisions of 194O, which provides that in case there is an e-commerce operator, is a domestic e-commerce operator, he's a resident, there's an e-commerce operator, not necessarily resident, he's an e-commerce operator, and there's an e-commerce participant. Now, e-commerce participant should be someone who's a resident in India, then 194O will be applicable. For example, if you look at Amazon, Cloudtail is an e-commerce participant who is engaged into e-commerce activity of online sale of goods and services through an e-commerce facility, which is run by an e-commerce operator. So Cloudtail becomes an e-commerce participant, and the Amazon in India becomes an e-commerce operator. So now how these transactions and how the levy will, how the TDS and TCS provisions will work in this particular scenario is what we need to see. Again, there are broadly two business models. One, the Cloudtail sells to Amazon and Amazon sells to customers like us. So it goes from the Cloudtail, the purchase is happening by the Amazon. Amazon sells it to the customer. Second kind of scenario is where the Amazon or the Cloudtail directly sells to the customer. The payment happens to Amazon. Amazon may pay directly to Cloudtail, and it may retain its commission of 20%, 25%, whatever it may be. So these are two broad kind of transactions could happen. There would be another variation in the second transaction where the customer makes a direct payment to the Cloudtail, and they in turn may be paying commission to the Amazon for facilitating this particular sale. Now, if you look at the first transaction where Amazon purchases goods and then does a further sales to the customer, in my view, those kind of transactions will not be covered under 194O. Because 194O is applicable where 194O will be applicable where the facilitator role is placed by the e-commerce operator and sales is happening like Cloudtail directly to the customer. That's a clear language used in 194O, where the facilitation only should be happening by the e-commerce operator, where e-commerce operator acts as a buyer or acts on a principal-to-principal basis as a buyer and seller. In those cases, 194O will not be applicable. So one leg of transaction where Amazon makes a payment to the Cloudtail, those transactions will be covered by 206C. Now, if you look at the second transaction where the CloudTail directly sells to the customer, and customer in turn makes a payment to Amazon, and Amazon may be making payment to the CloudTail. Those kind of transactions will be covered under 194 Capital O. So this is how the transactions will have to be bifurcated between 206C and 194O. Now, in the second leg of transaction, if 194O is applicable, then 206C will not be applicable, because second provision of 206C1H is very clearly provide. If the transaction is liable for TDS, then TCS on that will not be applicable. So they are mutually exclusive to that extent, and only one levy should happen, not both levies should happen.
Okay. So let's take an example over here. So if a customer buys products online, offline, but makes the payment through Paytm, so in that case, will 194O be applicable?
Yeah. So again, this is an interesting scenario where suppose we go to a nearby shop and there's a purchase activity happening from the nearby shop, or it could be anything. I mean, it could be where we are using Paytm and other payment facilities for various kind of transactions. Now, if I buy product online, offline, will 194O be applicable? As I already mentioned, 194O, for 194O to trigger, there are three important components: that there should be an e-commerce participant, there should be an e-commerce operator, and there should be a transaction which is happening on that, but and the facilitation for a purchase, online sale of service of the products or services is happening through the e-commerce operator. Now, if I go to a nearby Kirana shop, or for anyone that matter, and do a purchase, but my payment happens through, say, Paytm or Google Pay or any other payment mode. In my opinion, these are only modes of payment, and these are not a transaction which are facilitated by the e-commerce operator. And the nearby Kirana shop will not qualify as an e-commerce participant in this particular case, because in this particular scenario, because he is doing the transaction offline. So offline transaction where the payment mode is, say, Google Pay or Amazon Pay or various other kind of transaction, just because the e-commerce operator is involved, I would feel that 194 Capital N should not be applicable.
Okay. Yeah, just to add on that, basically, if I try to link it with the financial sector also, for example, like I am a financing NBFC and I give my customers, borrower, an option to pay their EMI through Paytm. Now, can that analogy apply, and can Paytm say that whatever I pay to you will be subject to 194O? And to address that, as Narendra said, there are three things. One is e-commerce operator, and one is e-commerce participant, and e-commerce service. Definitely, Paytm is a e-commerce operator, but am I a e-commerce participant? Because I am not conducting this sale through, or I am not sourcing my product through the Paytm network. So I would be, my situation is probably just like a recipient of service, and one leg of my entire transaction is getting through, routed through this Paytm model. However, there are emerging models of business where there is a crowdfunding, and in that case, if that model, entire business of a loan, etc., is generated through an online platform, and then there is a Paytm or any other network provider which, or any e-commerce operator helping conduct that entire business, then certainly in that case 194O may get triggered.
Okay, so let's move on to the next question. So taxability of income earned by e-commerce operator for hosting advertisements for providing any other services.
If you look at this again, the 194O, 194O very specifically talks of these kind of situations. So the e-commerce operator may get two kinds of revenue. One is the commission which they get from the participants because they're facilitating in their online sale of goods. And second, they may also get revenue in terms of hosting for particular advertisement or certain other services connected with this. Now, 194O very specifically provides that the hosting of advertisement or provision of services will be excluded from the ambit of 194O. So in those cases, if a participant, e-commerce participant, makes a payment to e-commerce operator for hosting advertisement, etc., those will have to be dealt with the other provisions of TDS, like 194C or 194J, whatever those provisions may be. And that leg of transaction, the payer will have to deduct TDS. The exclusions, these are very clearly excluded from the 194O. Now, if the e-commerce operator is resident, this is how the TDS deductions will have to happen under the 194J or 194C. If the e-commerce operator is a non-resident, then the challenge will arise. As Keshav mentioned, there's an overlap here, because whether that kind of thing will come under the equalization levy or it will be a 916 kind of a thing, where can it be classified as a royalty, and which will be applicable, will lead to an interesting problem, which will have to be resolved as the time goes forward. Existing litigations will have to be read as per the existing provisions, because all these provisions are prospective in nature and they do not have any retrospective impact. And the levy of equalization or non-levy of equalization, non-levy will not make any difference. As we had seen the Google India's case, they said levy of equalization doesn't mean earlier it was not taxable. So it could be taken as taxable in the earlier provisions itself, and equalization levy is a different mode of taxing it. So I would feel that existing litigation, the interpretation as per the existing provisions will have to be done. And going forward, these new provisions will have to be applicable. And if there is an equalization levy, then that will have precedence. The taxation will be under equalization levy. If it is a 194O item, that means if it falls, a particular transaction falls in 194 capital O, 194O overrides all other TDS provisions, and the deduction will have to be done under 194O itself, except for hosting advertisement and provision of service by the e-commerce operator.
Okay, so so on certain transactions, there are indirect tax implications, and there might be implications under the new provisions as well. So will this lead to double taxation?
Yeah, actually speaking, there have been certain taxes, indirect tax, already applicable on e-commerce. And this is something not new. There is a category which is called online information download and services, which is there since 2016, basically. And that also talks about that it is a service tax or online information and database access or retrieval, wherein GST applies as well as service tax was applicable. And in that case, again, it talks about little bit of an extraterritorial jurisdiction, where the recipient of the service need to do a compliance under reverse charge if it is a person registered under this GST Act. And the way those legislation have been drafted, even such companies which are providing online information and database access services, if they are providing services to person who are not registered in under the GST, they should do the compliance. And there is a place of supply rule under section 13.12 of IGST Act, which deals that these will be liable under reverse charge. And there are number of conditions under which such category of service will be taxable. And if I may read some of the condition, that the location of the address presented by the recipient of service through internet is in the taxable territory, the credit card or debit card or store value or charge card, basically the payment mechanism by which the recipient of service settle, has been issued in the taxable territory, the billing address of the recipient of the service is in the taxable territory, the internet protocol of the device used by the recipient is in the taxable territory, the bank of the recipient of the account used is maintained in the taxable territory, country code of the subscriber, IM, SIM card used by the recipient is in taxable territory, or the location. So there are several conditions, and if two of the conditions are fulfilled, those condition, this service is liable for a GST. So there is a case, now the similar service, in this case what will happen, suppose somebody taking this service, he will have to pay GST and a reverse charge, and the provider of the service need to pay the equalization levy on this charge. And there is a bit of a double taxation, as I could see in this.
Sure. So let's take one more example. Is withholding under Section 194O applicable when payment is made directly by the customers through e-commerce participants or sellers? For example, transaction of train bookings through IRCTC.
Before I address this, just want to add a couple of points to what Keshav mentioned, that whether there's a double taxation under one under indirect taxes in the earlier question, whether there's a double taxation because there is also a GST implication on these kind of a transaction, and there is also equalization levy. Now, whether it will result in double taxation is on the same transaction. Now, that will have to be tested applying the current principle, and one of them is the aspect theory under the constitutional law, that whether the levy is on the same item and who can levy it. Because if the levy is falling under the GST provisions, 246 capital A of the Constitution, then there would be a challenge for levy of equalization levy itself. So for that, first one will have to determine whether the equalization levy will be an income tax or whether it's in GST. So that aspect is very important, because measure is same. That means that the levy is on the sale consideration. The measure doesn't make a difference for the charge. The charge will have to be tested separately. And if the levy is on two different aspects of the same transaction, it could still be constitutionally valid. So coming back to this question, where the transactions, where the payments are directly happening by the customer to the e-commerce participants or sellers, an e-commerce operator may be involved in facilitating, or what is his role? So if you look at the explanation under 194O subsection 1, it says that when the e-commerce operator is deducting TDS, he should also include the amount of direct sales which are happening from between the customers, and where the direct payments have happened to the e-commerce participant. Even that is deemed to be in consideration for the purpose of deduction payment for the purpose of deduction of TDS under 194O. Now, IRCTC example may not be very apt here, because IRCTC, the government is involved, and the government being excluded from the TDS provisions under 196 of the Income Tax Act. So if I'm making a payment to the government, and how the IRCTC will react to that will not make a difference, because ultimately the income is of the government, and the train bookings are coming, train revenue from the passengers, etc., is for to the government. So 196 will protect that kind of a transactions. But it could be different other transactions also, which will be relevant, where if I'm purchasing something from Amazon and direct payment has happened in terms of to the customers, or if you take Uber and Ola, where you are making direct payment to the driver. Those kind of transactions, if other tests of 194O are applicable, also when the payment is made to these particular e-commerce participants, they will be liable for TDS under 194O, because there is a specific explanation for this. But we need to distinguish this with certain different kind of transactions. For example, if you take Just Dial. Now here you have get the reference, or you take OLX. You just get the details of the seller of a particular commodity or a service provider. You contact him directly, and you may be doing transactions directly with them. The platform, like a Just Dial, may really not be involved how much we charge, how much the service provider charges, or how much or in case of an OLX, what is the deal between the buyer and seller of the old items. So those kind of transactions, can we say, will be also be covered under 194O? In my view, they will not be covered. The reason why I state so is that 194 very clearly says there should be facilitation of the online transaction by the e-commerce operator. Now, if the e-commerce operator, we can say that has not facilitated, just if he gives me an address and contact number of a particular person, I would not say that is a facilitation of transaction. Facilitation of transaction would mean the entire thing where he helps me to conclude the contract or conclude the sales. That would mean the facilitation of the transaction. Otherwise, this ambit would be very wide, and it would be practically impossible for someone like an OLX or Just Dial to comply with 194O.
Sure. Yeah. So we have one last question before we move on to the questions posted by the audience. So considering we'll have to put in place a mechanism to account for the taxes withheld, will there be a requirement to make changes to the internal systems, accounting and billing mechanisms?
Yeah, if I may take this, primarily as we speak, this is going to take huge changes in terms of the compliance, and there would be a periodical return filing, etc. And what we are talking about, certain method where the online transaction happened 24/7, and as I quoted some of the volume of the transactions, certainly we will need to involve a greater level of changes in our accounting system, internal and billing system, so that we are able to do a complete kind of compliance. Not only compliance, there would be a transaction level tedious thing which will involve a robust accounting and reconciliation part, because not only the TDS need to be deducted, but it needs to be matched with the transaction level. So that will again be an important aspect, and it will again lead to a part of a cash flow issue when there's this kind of a 1% TDS. So for all these purpose, I feel there is an urgent requirement to overhaul your accounting systems.
Okay, sure. So maybe we can take a few questions from the audiences, the ones that audiences have requested for. So first question, whether payment for availing Zoom facility is subject to equalization levy?
So Zoom is, and having an, I mean, we'll have to again test it whether Zoom can be qualified as e-commerce operator. Naturally, I would feel yes, because he is making available a particular facility through which an online sale of goods can happen and online provision of service can happen. Now, Zoom basically helps us to do video conferencing. So is it a provision of service? So again, the same issue what we had dealt with when we are looking at Netflix, that whole question is whether it's a provision of service. In case of Zoom, I would feel that yes, they are enabling us to do video conferencing or do video calls or webinars, etc. So to that extent, there is a service which they are making available, and this should be liable for equalization levy, assuming other conditions are satisfied.
And just to add, I think Zoom is one of the biggest beneficiary of this COVID thing. And if I read it correctly, the market cap of the Zoom promoters have multiplied.
In fact, all the digital service provider are the biggest beneficiary of this COVID-19. People are blaming China that they might have done something for their benefit, but the real beneficiary are these IT companies.
Sure. We have one more question. So is any clarification or guidance expected from the CBDT government or the government? If yes, when?
See, on this issue, I think government is engaging, and very senior officers from the CBDT side and have come on some similar Zoom call organized by a professional body, where they have taken note of these issues which have been highlighted. And they are saying at the earliest convenience, they will come out with the suitable clarification. And however, the intention is clearly to tax and continue this equalization levy. There have been a representation, industry representation, that in view of such a hurriedly introduced law and the many of the open questions to be addressed, whether this law should be deferred from 1/4/2020 to 1st of October, like in case of 194O. But still, the intention of the government seems to be going ahead with this thing. They will certainly issue the clarification. One good thing I would like to point here is that in this COVID scenario, I have seen a very, very proactive response from the government side, and I would like to thank CBDT for that. Particularly if you see every day they have come up with any of the issue which have been raised, be it a 100% deduction for the PM CARES where there was ambiguity, be it about the extending the existing nil withholding tax certificate, and even clarifying the operating model thereof. So possibly they would soon come out with the clarification.
Okay. The next question is, can EL be used as a tax planning tool where income tax payable at a higher rate? For example, EL is payable at 2% and get exemption from income tax at 10% at the cost of not getting tax credits in home country or resident country.
So again, this is an interesting aspect. Cases where there is a scenario where a particular transaction can fall in both under the EL definition as well as under the definition of either 916 or 917 royalty and FTS, there could be the question that how would you address this particular thing? For example, if you say download of software, is it a royalty or is it covered under the EL? So whether if it is covered under the EL, the levy today would be 2%. Whereas if it is covered under 195 read with 916, the tax would be at 10% plus, depending on the treaty scenario, surcharge and cess would be applicable. But one more angle that we should keep it in mind here is the amendment which has happened in the Act. Now, in the earlier scenario, in the 2016 EL law, if a particular item of advertisement was liable for equalization levy, then it was not liable for income tax. There was a specific exemption to that under Section 10, Subsection 50. Now, the 10, Subsection 50 has been amended even by 2020 Finance Act, but that amendment they have made effective from the assessment year 22-23. Now, that is an interesting thing that they have not amended that from 21-22. So, if you look at the current year, there's a situation where the on a transaction, there is a chance that both income tax and EL could be applicable at least for 1 year. Now, in the subsequent year, there will be a situation where if a particular transaction is falling in EL, if I feel that it is satisfying the test of online service on e-commerce supply or service, in my view, EL will take precedence over the Income Tax Act, because once under 195 is applicable only if the income is chargeable to tax. But if the exemption under 1050 says that if it is liable for EL, it is exempt under the Income Tax Act, you can very well take that course of action and do it. But for a buyer to do it will have its own implication. So if a buyer takes a call that I will not deduct TDS, then he has to be clear in terms of implication under 195 read with 201, disallowance under 40a. All those things, the buyer will have to be very clear in terms of what he is doing, what action he is taking about on this.
Okay, we have one more question. Whether goods for the purposes of EL includes actionable claims, shares, securities?
No, it cannot include. It will have to be goods. I mean, these actionable claims, others will be excluded from the meaning.
Okay. So one last question before we end the end today's web session. So, okay, maybe I can take this one. So whether EL paid in India is available as tax credit in foreign country under DTA to NR operator?
That would again depend on the respective countries. The whole question is whether can you say EL is a tax, is it an income tax under the Indian law? Can we say it is an income tax? Because it will have to satisfy the definition of tax under the treaty provisions. And the treaty will have to say that it satisfies the test of tax. And generally the treaty would say tax, income tax as per the Income Tax Act or tax levied under the Income Tax Act. There could be different wordings used in a particular statute. So, or the residual clause will say any other subsequent similar tax levied subsequently. Those things also will be covered in the definition of tax. If you look at the definition, if you look at the e-commerce committee report, which had referred for levy of EL, there they had made a statement, this will be an issue which the foreign country where the non-resident is resident, the government of that country will have to take and view whether the EL will be available for foreign tax credit or not. As far as India is concerned, really, we are not concerned whether the credit will be available or not. From the Indian government's point of view, they want to levy this tax. That credit will depend entirely on the treaty with the respective country. Can we say it satisfies the definition of tax in that particular treaty and the domestic tax provisions of that particular country?
Okay, so we have certain additional questions, but in interest of time, apologies from my side, we won't be able to take up all the questions. But I think we had a great discussion today. Thank you so much, Keshav sir and Narendra sir, for sharing your thoughts and insights. I would also like to thank all the participants. Thank you for joining us. But before we conclude today's session, I would request Harshad Nathu, our customer success manager, to take all the participants through a brief demo of the Riverus telescope offering. Over to you, Harshad.
Thank you, Saili. So I'll just brief you about Riverus. Riverus is a legal tech company, and we have a tool for income tax research. So Riverus telescope is an AI-powered information product that empowers tax professionals by providing latest information and instant insights on the most pressing tax issues relevant to the professional's business. So what you can see on the screen is the landing page of our product, where you get a readily information available based on issues. So like, if you just take any of these issues, like first issue which we updated yesterday, issue examined under the original assessment proceedings, whether reopening of such case is justified. So there are around 27 cases on this and three laws which are applicable. So these are the subject tags attached to this. So if you want to search within this library, you can use this filter. So you can filter it using the subjects or based on the topics as well. So I'll just open one of the issues. So if you just open this issue, you will get a brief description. So exactly what this issue talks about. Then the next tab on the left-hand side is the legislation. So here you will get access to all the relevant sections, notifications, circulars, which are relevant to this issue. Then are the top cases. So whatever are the important cases on this, you will find it on this tab. So the philosophy behind this is like maximum amount of time which you spend on your research, it's searching for the right data. And income tax issues are more or less similar across nation. So people are investing their resources on researching on the same thing everywhere. So why not to provide it at a one place? So here you get a ready library available of this research. So all the cases have been listed here, the key points of the case, and the outcomes, you can find it here. And most importantly, this product is mobile friendly. So you can simply access this on your cell phone as well. And there is a tracking mechanism as well. So like if you start following an issue today, and if something new comes up related to this issue, let us say 2 months down the line, we will add it in the same bucket and we will send you a notification. So as you see on the screen, this particular case, which is there in the tracker, which was decided on 26th of March. So this is how you can keep your knowledge updated. Also, there is an option to follow certain issues which are of your interest. So once you start following it, we will send you a notification here like this. And you can quickly have a look at it when you have a free time of 15-20 minutes or when you are traveling in a car. Along with this, we also have the industry tracking available. So some of the professionals are catering to very specific industry. So industry-wise classification have been done and all the related cases to this particular industry have been clubbed and they have put it in a one bucket. So you can start following an industry as well. Similar to industries, we also have the party-wise tracking. So if you want to like track any specific party, what are the cases handled by them or what are the cases dealt by them? So you can track that party as well. So let it be the case related to TDS, transfer pricing, computation, anything, you will find it here. So if you don't find any industry or a party, the last option here is for the request. So you can just send us a party name or the industry name which you want to track and we will make sure that it is added in our database. Similarly applies to issues as well. So like if you don't find any of the issue of your interest in this issue bank, you can simply ask this to us. So we will make sure that we will work on it and we will add it in our database as soon as possible. Also, this product comes with one more thing, that is research map. So basically this is a repository of over 450,000 reported and unreported cases in income tax. So you can also access those cases here just by putting a keyword. And a unique feature over here is the judge analytics. So like if you are presenting a case before any specific judge, you can get a sense how he thinks or what is the criteria which what he applies while deciding a case. So I'll quickly show you one of the famous judge, Mr. Vasudevan. who was earlier in Bombay and currently who is at Bangalore. So total number of cases done by him, the cases disposed of by him, then the benches where he have been a judge, then outcome of those cases, that information you will get. The interesting feature here is the most referred cases. So what we have done, we have analyzed all those 4,000 odd cases done by Mr. Vasudevan. And we found out that these are the cases which he likes to quote in his judgments. So for example, this first case, EY Lilly company, he have used this case as a precedent in 202 other cases. So like this, if you could relate your matter to any of this case, it will be easier for him to understand the matter. And below that, you see, you can have access to all those 4,400 cases. So there are various filters available on the left-hand side based on forum, based on the year of decision, outcome, section, subjects, etc. Many filters are available and everything you see on the screen is clickable. Then if you want to see the precedents used by a judge on any particular subject, you can simply go to precedent search. And if you want to have a look at the cases used as a precedent by Mr. Vasudevan on one of the matters, let us say penalty, you can just add a keyword over here. So there are around 380 results. Of course, 380 is a large number. You can add multiple keywords. So he'll just add penalty and prosecution. So there are around 12 cases which Mr. N.V. Vasudevan relies upon while deciding the cases related to penalty and prosecution. So this is how you can decide your litigation strategy. I'll again go back to the home page. So here there is one more thing, that is super search. So super search is basically more powered search, wherein you can pre-select the parameters on which you want to see the cases. So judge-wise, lawyer-wise, like you can select. If you want to search using the keywords, you can precisely search for the keywords in six things, either in the full judgment, issue statements, key points, holdings, arguments, or even in the black letter law. So the OR functionality is given here. So if you want to look for the key phrases, either of, you can use the OR filter. If one of them is the mandatory, you can use the AND filter. Similarly, if you want to exclude any specific keyword, you can use the exclude filter over here. And similar logic also is given there for the sections. So if you want to see the interplay between two sections, you can use this. So the OR logic is given and AND filter is also given here. I'll again go back to the home page. Here the next tab available is the laws. So if you want to search for any statutory information, you can use this search bar. So just add a keywords and he'll throw up the results with respect to sections, rules, notifications, circulars, etc. Otherwise, all the sections have been listed here chapter wise. So if you just want to have a look at any of this, you can simply click on this. So let us say section number 10A. All the related sections are available here. So if you want to read two or more sections parallelly, then direct link is available here. Related rules are below that. Notifications are there. Circulars are also there. On the right hand side, you can see the complete amendment history is given here. So the blue color balls which you can see on the screen are the years in which there was an amendment. So if you want to see what was the act applicable to any specific year, you can directly click there and you can jump to the act which was relevant for that particular financial year. You want to see the cases on particular section, those are available here. And next interesting part here is the legislative intent for section 10A. So sometimes the judges also use the intent while deciding a case. So if you want to see how the intent for this section has been used while deciding a case, you can simply go to legislative intent. And when you click on read more here, the intent what they have used, we have highlighted it in the purple color. I'll again go back to the home page. Then similar to judges, we also have the lawyer profile. So if you want to look for the profile of any specific lawyer, you can simply add it here. I'll quickly show you the normal search engine what we have. You can go to cases here and you can start typing your queries over here. So if you, let us say if you want to see a cases related to foreign exchange fluctuations, you can like select these phrases over here and he'll throw you the results. So there are around 2700 odd cases on this. So there is a one interesting feature available here to sort this result. So by default, it is by relevance. If you want to see the latest cases, you can sort it by latest. And the last one is the popularity. So popularity is to say that number of times the particular case has been used as a precedent while deciding a case. So for example, this first case, this case has been used as a precedent 751 times. So that's why it is coming on top. So I'll quickly open this. So once you open this case, left hand side judicial information is available, judges involved, lawyers involved, etc. Then below that is the complete timeline that how the case has traveled from ITAT to High Court to Supreme Court, etc. with the all interim hearing dates. Available citations are given here. If you want to have a look at the true copy of the judgment, you can download it from here. Then available citations from the other journals are available, so you can use it in your submission. And the key points of the case are available, and the black letter law. Then you can see there are like three colors on the screen, blue, orange, and pink. So what we have done, we have highlighted the issues and grounds of appeal in blue color, arguments in orange color, and holding and outcome in pink color. So even if you just go through the highlighted text of this case, you can understand the gist. And if you want to read it in detail, the complete judgment is also available on the same page. Right hand side, you will get access to what are the sections discussed in this case. Then this case refers to, that means the backward citations. If any other case was relied upon while deciding this particular case, you get access to all those cases. Also, below that is the forward citations or forward references. That is, this case is mentioned in. So that is to say that if this particular case was used as a precedent while deciding any other case, you get access to it here itself. If you just click on view all, you will get the complete list of the cases which used it as a precedent, the forum which used it, bench which used it, outcome, decision year, and assessment year. We'll again go back to the home page. Also, you can add a tag to your cases, which will help you to retry your research work later on. So these are the few tags which I have created for my research work or which are there on my desk. So like one of the case I had tagged recently, the next to the download true copy button, there is a button to tag a case and it will help you to retry. So you can create your tag section wise, subject wise, or even based on the your client names. So this is brief about the product. You all are eligible to take a trial till 4th of May. We are offering 1 month free trial to you. So if you are interested, please write down to us at hello@riveres.in and we will activate your trial. Thank you. Over to you, Sheesh.
All right. I think this was a very interesting and useful session. A vote of thanks to the panelists. I think it was a wonderful session. We enjoyed the conversation. Thank you, Saili, for hosting the show, and I really want to thank all the participants who spent the time, who probably spent 20 minutes extra being on this conversation. So thanks a lot. I hope you have a great weekend ahead, and maybe a follow-up for this session might be needed, so we will discuss with our panelists and see how to take that forward. Thank you once again. The recording of this session will be made available to you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.